Good evening, everyone, both here in Louisville and online. It's good to be here with you. My name is David Buckley, and I'm the Paul Weber Endowed Chair in Politics, Science, and Religion here at the University of Louisville. And I'm very, very pleased this evening to be able to welcome to our campus Dr. David Campbell, who you'll hear a lot more about in just a second. I want to start out by thanking, first of all, Gary Gregg and everybody at the McConnell Center. It's been a real pleasure to work with Gary and everyone at McConnell on the series of events that we've put together this spring on the intersection between religion and American democracy. It's what I research, so of course I think it's important, and hopefully you've all come to think a little bit about that in different ways too this semester. I will, at this point, get out of the way and introduce Peyton Brooks. Peyton is a McConnell Scholar here at the university in her junior year, and we're so glad to have her. Welcome, Dr. Campbell, to our campus. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Buckley, and thanks to the Paul Weber Chair for co-sponsoring this program with us tonight. My name is Peyton Brooks, and I am a junior McConnell Scholar here at the University of Louisville. And thank you for watching tonight. Tonight we will continue our year exploring variety left and right, where we are seeking understanding of the variety of political, social, and economic thought in America today. This month we are focusing on our changing religious environment in America and its impact on political thought. Earlier this month we hosted Mark David Hall and Eric McDaniel, who shared two different takes on Christian nationalism. Next month we will host President Kevin Cosby and Dr. Ricky Jones on Black political and social thought. We invite you all to participate in those events. We also urge you to catch up on this year's programming on the McConnell Center YouTube page or the McConnell Center podcast. Tonight we have the pleasure of hosting Dr. David Campbell. David Campbell is the Packey J. Deep Professor of American Democracy at the University of Notre Dame. His research focuses on civic and political engagement with particular attention to religion and young people. His most recent book is Secular Surge, A New Fault Line in American Politics, which received the Distinguished Book Award from the Society for Scientific Study of Religion. Among his other books is American Grace, How Religion Divides and Unites Us. Winner of the award from the American Political Science Association for the best book on government, politics, or international affairs. Professor Campbell, it is our pleasure to welcome you to the McConnell Center.
Well, thank you very much, Peyton, for that very generous introduction, and to my good friend Dave Buckley as well. I'm grateful to the McConnell Center and to the Paul Weber Chair and to everyone involved bringing me here to Louisville. I asked somebody, how do you pronounce the name of the capital of Kentucky? And they said, well, I'm not sure if it's Louisville. And I said, it's Frankfurt. Ha! That was my lame attempt at a joke. Now, here's my attempt at local color. I went to the Slugger Museum today and got myself a Louisville Slugger bat. I'm very proud of this. And I actually got to hold Hank Aaron's bat, or one of Hank Aaron's, allegedly one of his bats. Allie Rose, is the clicker around here? Thank you. Well, as was mentioned in the introduction, I'm going to talk a little bit today about some changes in the American religious and political landscape. You can see the title of the talk, which is about religious backlash. And we'll spend a fair amount of time talking about just what I mean by backlash and what its implications are. I mean, if you're interested in learning more about what I'm going to talk about tonight, you're more than welcome to purchase a copy of Secular Surge, which I should mention is also authored with Jeff Lehman and John Green. As usual, they should not be held responsible for any of the nonsense that I might share with you today, but you know, if you like it, it's all me, and if you don't, you can blame Jeff and John. But anyway, I should also mention that Secular Surge makes a great wedding gift, great Christmas, Hanukkah, you name it. All right. As I said, to set the scene for tonight, I'm actually going to start with some video clips. We're actually going to watch a fair number of video clips tonight. I'm going to start with one from a speech given at my home institution of Notre Dame. But I assure you, that happens to be a coincidence. I would show you this speech wherever the speech had been given or wherever I happened to be located. The speech was given by the then Attorney General Bill Barr. He came to Notre Dame's law school and gave what is, I think, fair to say, quite a remarkable, even unusual speech for a serving Attorney General of the United States to give. Because in the speech, he decried the rise of secularism in America. Now, it's a pretty long speech, so I'm not going to show you all of it. I have just spliced together a few clips. And I want to start with this because Barr is making a case for why people should be concerned about growing secularism in America. We're going to watch that clip, and then we're going to watch another that is sort of a rebuttal, if you will. But let's start with the Attorney General speaking at Notre Dame just a few years ago. Allie Rose, would you mind starting that clip?
First, is the force, fervor, and comprehensiveness of the assault on organized religion we are experiencing today. This is not decay. This is organized destruction. Secularists and their allies have marshaled all the forces of mass communication, popular culture, the entertainment industry, and academia in an unremitting assault on religion and traditional values. These instruments are used not only to affirmatively promote secular orthodoxy, but also to drown out and silence opposing voices and to attack viciously and hold up to ridicule any dissident. One of the ironies, as some have observed, is that the secular project has itself become a religion pursued with religious fervor. It is taking on all the trappings of religion, including inquisitions and excommunication. We must be vigilant to resist efforts by forces of secularization to drive religious viewpoints from the public square and to impinge upon our exercise. I can assure you that as long as I am Attorney General, the Department of Justice will be at the forefront of this effort, ready to fight for the most cherished of all our American liberties, the freedom to live according to our faith.
So there you have the Attorney General saying that he will pledge to defend America from the forces of secularism. Now, what's interesting about that speech, it got a fair amount of attention. I don't know if you remember when he delivered it. If you read the speech on paper, it sounds like a real stem winder. When you watch Bill Barr deliver it, it falls a little flat. So I'm going to show you now another clip where whatever you might think of the message, the messenger maybe is a slightly more impactful communicator. This is a television ad featuring none other than Ron Reagan Jr., yes, that Ron Reagan Jr., son of that Ron Reagan. You may have seen this ad. It actually still runs fairly often on cable television. I first saw it, and this is an interesting statement. I first saw it during the Democratic primary debates back way back in 2019. But anyway, this is a television ad, Ron Reagan Jr. Allie Rose.
Hi, I'm Ron Reagan. Unabashed atheist, and I'm alarmed by the intrusions of religion into our secular government. That's why I'm asking you to support the Freedom From Religion Foundation, the nation's largest and most effective association of atheists and agnostics, working to keep state and church separate, just like our founding fathers intended. Please support the Freedom From Religion Foundation. Ron Reagan, lifelong atheist, not afraid of burning in hell.
If you remember nothing else from this talk, you'll remember that line. He's not afraid of burning in hell. You see what I mean? Well, that's sort of a rebuttal to the Bill Barr speech. Barr is lamenting the rise of secularism, and here is Ron Reagan Jr. Advocating it, promoting it, encouraging people to join an organization that advocates for, as he puts it, the separation of church and state, which some people would define as secularism. So with those two viewpoints in mind, let me move to a roadmap of what we're going to talk about tonight. We're going to talk about the mystery of rising irreligion in America. I'll show you some evidence that people are turning away from religion in America, and suggest that it's a puzzle to solve. Then we're hopefully going to solve that mystery, and I'm going to propose that this theory of religious backlash is at least a partial explanation for what's going on. And then I'm going to close by just posing a question for you and suggesting a little bit of evidence on the point of whether or not we are witnessing a secular left movement emerging to parallel the religious right that has been such a prominent feature of American politics for roughly 40 years now. So those are the three things we'll be doing tonight. Let's start with the mystery of growing irreligion in America. What you're looking at is a chart of the General Social Survey, which is widely considered to be the gold standard of social scientific studies of American values and opinions. It goes all the way back to the early 1970s. The General Social Survey asks all sorts of questions, but among them are questions about people's religion, including whether or not they have a religion. Do they identify with a religion? They also ask about your religious attendance. And beginning in the mid-1980s, they also began to ask a question about whether or not you believe in God. This graph shows you the trends in those three things, whether or not people identify with a religion, that's this line, whether they report never attending worship services, that's this line, and whether or not they say they do not believe in God. That's this line. Now, a few things I want you to notice. First of all, if you wind the clock back to the early 1970s and kind of go from the early 70s through the late 1980s, early 1990s, the line for people who say they have no religion and who say they never attend religious services, those lines are pretty much flat. And then something happens in late 1980s, early 1990s, that leads to this inflection point. And you begin to see this growth in people who say they have no religion or who say they never attend religious services. That is the sort of puzzle the social scientists love to try to answer. What happened? Why do we see that trend begin then? And why do we continue to see that growth every year when the General Social Survey comes out, or the Pew Research Center has done a new survey, or the Gallup poll, or any of a variety of other sources of data, all of which show exactly the same trend. Every year when they come out with a new data point, I keep expecting these numbers to plateau, but they don't, at least not as of yet. They continue to go up. They're probably not going to go up forever, but for now, that seems to be the trend. I also want you to notice something else, though, that while you see an increase in people who say they don't believe in God, that is a very different thing than saying that you do not have a religious affiliation. Having no religious affiliation, in turn, is not the same thing as saying you don't attend religious services. In other words, we are seeing this growth of irreligion in America, of secularism, but the secular population is complicated. To say you don't necessarily have a religion doesn't mean that you don't believe in God. In fact, sometimes it goes the other way, that people who don't believe in God do have a religious affiliation. So we've got a puzzle. What is going on? Why do we see this growth happening at this time? Now, there are lots of potential explanations. Lots of things are going on in the world, and I actually am not going to suggest that the theory that I'm putting forward tonight is the only explanation. But I am going to suggest that it is the one that best fits the timing. So audiences often say, well, it must have been the internet. No, it couldn't have been the internet because the timing isn't right. People didn't have the internet in their home in 1990. That didn't come until later. Or maybe it's just kids these days. Well, it turns out the kids these days, they've always been less religious than their parents. And that kind of change can't explain, bam, what happened in the late 1980s, early 1990s. Perhaps it was the end of the Cold War. That actually is a plausible theory and does fit the timing. But that doesn't explain why those numbers keep going up. It would explain why things changed at a certain point in time, right? Because they're changing at roughly the same time that the Cold War ended. But why would they keep growing? So what would it be? Well, I want to suggest to you that it has something to do with the fusion of religion and politics in America, or specifically the fusion of religion and partisan politics, or even more specifically the fusion of religion and conservative politics, specifically the rise of the religious right. So what I want to do for a few minutes is just to demonstrate to you something that you actually already know, but I just want to reinforce how natural it seems today in our politics for politicians to use what is sometimes called God talk. And as I show you these examples, I just want to remind you how, A, in the United States, this is historically unusual. This is not something that we've heard candidates do over the whole course of American history. And it is certainly unusual when you compare the United States to other liberal democracies. Some examples of what I mean by that fusion of religion and politics, and then we'll talk about why that might lead people to turn away from religion. I want to start with George W. Bush. Remember him? This is, of course, a picture of George W. Bush. He was often photographed or filmed in settings like this. In this case, he's speaking actually in a church, but Bush often spoke about his own religious background. He often used the language of evangelical Christianity. He wasn't the first presidential candidate to do that, but we often think of George W. Bush as really mobilizing the religious right as a political constituency. The other picture, this is a little more obscure. I'm actually going to ask if anybody in the audience knows. Here's a little bit of trivia. Does anybody know who that is a picture of? This is a deep cut. You'll be forgiven if you don't know, because this is pretty obscure. This is George Pataki. This is George Pataki, former governor of New York. Now, why do I have a picture of George Pataki on the screen? Well, it enables me to tell you a story that I think helps to make my point. If nothing else, it's funny. George Pataki in this picture is speaking at the 2004 Republican National Convention. Now, notice the podium that he is speaking at. Can you see how it sort of looks like there might be a cross in the podium? You see that once I point it out? Well, I was a brand new assistant professor at Notre Dame, and I'd written a few things about religion and politics, so somehow I got on the Rolodex of some reporter who called me from Madison Square Garden, where the Republican convention was being held, because he wanted to ask my opinion and whether I thought that the podium at the Republican National Convention had a cross on it to subliminally communicate to voters that the Republican Party was the pro-religion party. Now, when I got this call from the reporter, I said in that very professorial way, it doesn't matter whether there was a cross subtly embedded in the podium. This is not a party that is subtle about its use of religion. At this very convention, in prime time, they stopped the proceedings to say a prayer, a Christian prayer that closed in the name of Jesus Christ. Not subtle. Turns out the reporter didn't care. He just wanted to know, did I think it was a cross? Because apparently, if you teach at Notre Dame, you are an expert in crosses. Now, I couldn't figure out, did this reporter think that there was something to the story, or did he think it was ridiculous? And I didn't want to be made a fool of, so I hedged my bet again in that classic social science way, and I have been quoted in an Associated Press news story as saying the following. I can't say for sure whether it's a cross, but it certainly has cross-like properties. My point is that this is an example of what I mean by the religious messaging that we find particularly concentrated on the political right. Now, you might say, well, that was George W. Bush, and that was a particular era. Surely that can't be the case for every Republican candidate, and maybe not for everyone, but certainly for a lot of them. So let me show you a few more examples. Now some television ads. We're going to start with an ad from Mitt Romney in 2012. Remember Mitt Romney? He's actually still around. But anyway, this is an ad that he ran during his general presidential campaign against Barack Obama.
President Obama used his health care plan to declare war on religion, forcing religious institutions to go against their faith. Mitt Romney believes that's wrong.
In 1979, a son of Poland, Pope John Paul II, spoke words that would bring down an empire. Be not afraid.
When religious freedom is threatened, who do you want to stand with?
I'm Mitt Romney, and I approve this message.
There is so much we could discuss about that ad. A Mormon candidate is using imagery of the Catholic Pope to appeal to evangelical Protestants. That is mind-blowing to me. But there it is. And again, another example of the sort of religious messaging that we find. Now, again, you might say, okay, well, that's Romney, and Romney had a sort of particular religious issue he had to worry about. What about other candidates? Well, let's see another one. Maybe you remember this guy. This is Ted Cruz.
Were it not for the transformative love of Jesus Christ, I would have been raised by a single mom without my father in the household. God's blessing has been on America from the very beginning of this nation. Over and over again, when we faced impossible odds, the American people rose to the challenge. This is our fight, and that is why I'm running for president of the United States.
I'm Ted Cruz, and I approve this message.
I just want to remind you, he's running for president of the United States, not to be pastor of your church. But you might have been confused by that. Now, why is Cruz using language like this? Of course, because he's appealing to a very important part of the Republican base, white evangelical Protestants. But again, you might be saying, okay, well, that's Ted Cruz, it's 2016, he's a candidate sort of known for being on that wing of the Republican Party. So let me show you another example. This is Marco Rubio, also in 2016. Rubio, unlike Cruz, is thought to be a little bit more of a moderate Republican, but here he is.
Our goal is the ability to live alongside our Creator for all time, to accept the free gift of salvation offered to us by Jesus Christ. The struggle on a daily basis as a Christian is to remind ourselves of this. The purpose of our life is to cooperate with God's plan. To those who much has been given, much is expected. And we will be asked to account for that, were your treasure stored up on earth or in heaven. And to me, I try to allow that to influence me in everything that I do. I'm Marco Rubio, and I approve this message.
Have I made my point? I could show you other data, but I'm willing to bet that you'll just believe me, that when we ask voters, which party do you think is more likely to have either just religious people in general or evangelical Protestants in particular, they get the message, and they tell us, oh, much more likely to be the Republicans than the Democrats. You'll notice, however, that thus far I have left out a particular Republican politician who you might remember. Before he went into politics, he hosted a television show called The Apprentice, did some other stuff too. It's all kind of fuzzy now. Now, what I can't show you is an ad of Donald Trump using religious language in the same way at Rubio and Cruz, and I could have shown you lots of others as well have used. But I can show you this, that he definitely had a lot of support among white evangelicals and churchgoers in general, particularly white churchgoers. So strongest support among white evangelicals, but fair amount of support among white churchgoing Catholics as well. These are just a few examples of the sort of fervor that Donald Trump has ignited. It's interesting, again, this could be the subject of another talk. It actually took a while for the religious right to warm up to Donald Trump when he was first running in the primaries. The support that he was getting from evangelicals, and I'm putting that in scare quotes, was actually from evangelicals who were not terribly devout. They were people who said, well, they don't go to church, and they're not really part of a religious community, but they still carried the label of evangelicals. That's where he first won support, and then eventually he managed to win overwhelming support among evangelicals. And he's very conscious of it. In fact, he's not afraid to talk in pretty transactional terms about his relationship with the white evangelical community. Here's an example of Donald Trump speaking at one of his rallies in 2019. Allie Rose, would you mind?
2020 is essentially just as important because they'll try and take it away, whether it has to do with religion. Our evangelicals are here tonight, and they're all over the place. And what we've done for them and for religion is so important. You know, the other side, I don't think they're big believers, and not big believers in religion, that I can tell you. You listen to some of them. They're trying to put out little statements. They're not working too well. Those statements are a little bit sort of not too good, huh? What is the word we want to use here? Now,
what does all this have to do with the rise of irreligion, or the turn toward religious non-affiliation, or what my co-authors and I call the secular surge? Well, the argument is, and I'll confess, this argument is not original to me. It actually came from two sociologists named Michael Hout and Claude Fisher, but a number of people in the circle of scholars in which I move have now sort of embraced this as a leading theory. The reasoning goes like this. Many Americans have an allergic reaction when they hear this mixture of religion and not just politics in general, but conservative politics. And who would have that allergic reaction? Well, it's people who were religious, or at least thought of themselves as having a religious identity, and didn't share the same politics. So this causes cognitive dissonance, this disconnect. Out there, there's this perception that if you are religious, you are also of one party and one political ideology. And if you are religious, but you don't identify with that party, or you don't share that ideology, you're faced with a choice. What do you do? How do you resolve that dissonance? Well, you could change your politics, or you could change your religion, which in this case would mean you pull away from religion. You disaffiliate. You become what regrettably have been called the nuns, meaning N-O-N-E, nun, because these are people who, when asked their religion, say, none, I don't have one. Now, this is a good example of the sort of thing we're talking about here. These are words written by someone who identified herself as Christy. She's commenting on a story on the New York Times website, and I just love this because she actually uses the term cognitive dissonance. So she's describing her reaction of when Donald Trump was elected with an overwhelming share of evangelicals, and she says, I just couldn't handle the cognitive dissonance. It's almost as though she had read our work. You have no idea how gratifying it was for us to find this. Somebody out there is actually paying attention. Okay, well, maybe not. I don't know, but now, this is an intriguing idea, right? Is it really the case that as the religious right grew in prominence, more and more Americans said, you know what? I'm going to stick with my politics and I'm going to drop my religion. Would they really put their politics before their religion? And there's a lot of evidence to suggest that yes, that's exactly what has happened. I'm going to just describe to you for a few minutes some work that my colleagues and I have done to test that. I'm going to explain to you some experiments that we've done. Now, when you hear the word experiment, you probably have a picture in your head of people in white lab coats and clipboards, and then subjects come into a lab and they get hooked up to machines and all sorts of nefarious things go on. And that's not at all what I'm describing. What I'm actually describing happens on a survey where we ask a representative sample of Americans questions about themselves, but we randomly assign some of them to read, in this case, a news story that reminds them, we're not suggesting this is the first time they've ever seen it, but it reminds them of this mixture of religion and politics. And our hunch was, is if we did that, we could actually get people to, at least in the short time frame of our experiment, pull away from religion, that we could actually cause people to disaffiliate from religion. Now, you might worry about the ethics of that. And it is sort of ironic that a professor from Notre Dame is running an experiment in which we're basically causing people to leave the church. Well, we don't actually think that's what's happening. But what we think is happening is sort of a temporary change in the way people describe themselves, which is actually how most Americans who say they have no religion, the nuns, that's how most of them actually are. They, rather than being dead set, I am a nun, they walk around with that in their head. No, most people are what we call liminals. They're sort of half in a religion, half out, and kind of depends on the circumstances whether or not they actually say they have a religion. Why? Because on a Tuesday, if you ask them, do you have a religion? They might say, well, I don't go to church, but I did go to a Methodist summer camp, and mom and dad were Methodists, so I guess I'm a Methodist. But then if you ask them on Thursday after they've seen a news report about the kind of thing that I've just shown you here, or an ad or something, they say, no, I'm not religious, because if I'm religious, that means that I'm one of those people, and I'm not one of those. Okay, so that's what we think we're doing in this experiment. So here's how it works. This one we call the clerical campaign experiment. We have a news story. This is what it looked like. I'm not going to read it all to you. I just want to show you what it looked like to convince you that it looked like this sort of thing that you would read online. And we have these two very generic white guys. one of these was a graduate student. Another one worked for us. And we made sure they both wore the navy blue suits and the white shirts and the red ties. We wanted to keep everything as consistent as possible. And we vary how they're described in the ad, and so, or in this news story, which is about a congressional race. These two were running against each other. So in one version, they don't say anything about religion, either one of them. In another version, they both talk about religion, and I don't know how well you can see that image, but here's one of them standing in front of three crosses. This is at a church in South Bend. And the other candidate is shown in worship also at a church in South Bend. That's one of my co-authors standing right there actually holding his hand. Yeah, we staged all of these. And we have variations. So we've got the Democrat talking about religion. We've got the Republican talking about religion. We've got them both. We actually vary how much religion is in the story. So we have a version that we call the strong religion that we just sort of hit it over the head. Let me give you an example. These are not the only words in the story that reference religion, but this gives you an example. So if they have no religion, one of the candidates just says, well, my deep roots in the area will help me represent the values of this community. What politician wouldn't say that? In another version, the candidate says, my deep roots in the area and my religious faith, just sort of leaves it open, just faith, right? And then in the heavy religion, it's not just faith, it's my commitment to Christ, right? And I'm really putting it forward that I'm a heavily religious person. So does that make sense? We're randomly assigning which version of this you get. You only get one of them. And after you get the story, we ask your religious affiliation. And we'd actually already asked you that a week ahead of time. So we can see what changes over the course of about a week. And the only thing that's different between one group and another group is luck of the draw. Some get one story, some get another. And what do we find? Evidence that is exactly what we would have expected from the religious backlash theory. This is what happens to the percentage of those who say they have no religious identity after they see a story where the Republican uses heavy religious language and the Democrat doesn't use any. It is Democrats who pull away from religion. And again, the only thing that can explain this is the story that they read, because they were randomly assigned to read one versus another. And you can see that the Democrats are also reacting in other cases as well. But this is the big one. That little star shows you that it's statistically significant. So again, when people are exposed, just one story, one little innocuous news story, we get a pretty big increase in the percentage of Democrats who say, yeah, I'm not religious. I don't have a religious affiliation. Here's another example. What happens when it's not just a politician? What if you mix a politician and a pastor together? Right? We know this happens a lot. So we ran another experiment, another fake news story. In this case, we've got local pastor supports Republican candidate. We have another version where he supports the Democratic candidate. So there we have a picture of the pastor, a lot of text in which he's speaking in the sort of rhetoric that you'd expect a pastor endorsing Republican candidate to say, and we have a little pull-out box just to emphasize what he's saying. America needs a moral reawakening. We must return to our biblical roots. Okay, so what happens when we have a pastor endorsing a Republican candidate? Again, we also tried what happened with a Democrat. Didn't expect anything, didn't find anything, but we thought we'd check. This is the key paragraph here. People of faith must work to end abortion, prevent the so-called transgender movement from destroying traditional roles for men and women, and stop government harassment of businesses who exercise their right not to serve homosexual couples. We are just really hitting it over the head here. This is our control group. Because we needed to have people who didn't get the version of the story with the pastor, we had to give them something to do. So we had to come up with something that we thought, okay, has to have bipartisan agreement. And that is a lot harder than you might think in America. We thought, okay, maybe puppy dogs? People like puppies? We thought, okay, they probably like reading, right? Because it had to be some kind of rally. So rather than a political rally, this is a local principal speaking at a rally. We kept him a white guy, and he's saying this very controversial statement that reading is the keystone to a good education. All right, so what happens, again, when we randomly assign people to see one of these versus another? Again, we see a reaction from Democrats, and this is when a conservative pastor is endorsing a Republican candidate. Okay? But I want you to notice something, and this is actually quite interesting. We only see the reaction when it's the mixture of the pastor and the candidate. If it's just the pastor, that doesn't seem to bother people. It's the mixture of the religion and the politics. That's what pushes people away from religion. That's the backlash. That's the allergic reaction. One more case. You might be wondering about what our friend Christy, the one who used the words cognitive dissonance, what our friend Christy remarked on, which was what we might call kind of a transactional way of thinking about the mixture of religion and politics. I showed you that clip of Donald Trump at a rally where he's very upfront in that, hey, we do lots of things for the evangelicals in my administration, and I expect to get a little love in return. So what happens when people are exposed to that way of thinking about the mixture of religion and politics versus other candidates? Say Mike Pence. Say whatever you want about Mike Pence, but by all indications, he's a sincerely religious person. And you can think of lots of other people in public life who are similar. So again, we have various news stories. Here's one with religious leaders showing support for Trump. And we have a pastor who acknowledges that even if he has not always been a devoted Christian, he, meaning Trump, will be our advocate. Right? So we want to know, what happens when people see that way of mixing religion and politics? Versus, here's another one. Religious leaders show support for Pence. So here's Mike Pence with a group of religious leaders. And now the same pastor is saying, it is clear that because he, that is Pence, is a devoted Christian, he will be our advocate. Okay? Now those are the names Trump and Pence. You might think, well, people maybe have sort of baked in attitudes about those two, right? President and vice president. So we also did the same thing with local congressional candidates. We just sort of made names up. But it's the same idea. One is sincerely religious. One is transactionally religious. And we have a control group. I'm only showing you this because I just love this picture of third graders visiting City Hall. And the idea is that if you read this story, it should have no effect on your religion. It might make you feel good about the world or something, but it's not, we think, going to lead you to be either more or less likely to say you have a religious affiliation. And what do we find? Basically the same results, although here, I should note, it's actually just young Democrats that react. And they react most to, believe it or not, the Mike Pence treatment when they hear about his sincere religion. They seem less troubled by at least the Trump version of the transactional religion, a little more so when it's just a congressional candidate. But the general story there is consistent, again, with this idea of backlash. Mix religion and politics, and you get some people pulling away from religion. Now, some of you, I can tell, are very skeptical of this. You're thinking, you ran an experiment with a bunch of people, and you're telling me that's supposed to explain this mega social trend in America? And I share your skepticism. If I could only bring to you the evidence from these little experiments that we run, yeah, you might have reason to be skeptical. But it turns out that in addition to our experiments, which show this, that you get this backlash when you use candidates use God talk, when pastors and politicians mix, so it varies a little bit depending on the candidate. It turns out when you look at people in the wild, that is, you're not running an experiment, but you actually go and just do a big survey of Americans. And in our case, what we did is we surveyed them once, then we surveyed them again, and then we surveyed them again, and then we surveyed them a fourth time. This is over a period of years, just to see what happens over time. What do you find? Over time, it is Democrats who become less or more likely to drop their religious affiliation, less likely to be religious. But it doesn't go the other way around. So it's not that people start out not having a religion and they become Democrats. It goes, they start out as Democrats, and over time, they drop their religion. And who are the Democrats who are doing that? Well, they're the ones who think the Republican Party is allied with the religious right. So if you were not convinced at all by the experiments, this, hopefully, is also somewhat convincing. And if you're not convinced by what we observe in the wild, well, then we gave you the experiments. That leads to a question, though. Okay, so let's say, perhaps, that I've convinced you that there's something to this idea of religious backlash, this allergic reaction to the mixture of religion and politics. And I showed you that there's this dramatic growth in the secular population in America. And that secular population is growing because of a movement called the religious right. Well, would that not lead you to think, aha, Professor Campbell, should that not mean that there would be a secular left? And maybe. After all, secularism is rising. And in evidence that I could show you, but will not detail here, but in the Q&A, happy to detail, the group we call secularists, really politically engaged. A very active group. So that suggests that maybe we are witnessing this congealing of a movement in the same way that if I were giving this talk in 1978 and was talking about this group of social conservatives who were appearing on the political scene, we didn't have a name for them yet, you would say, whoa, that guy was like a prophet. He predicted the rise of the religious right. Yeah, but here it gets a little complicated. So here's some signs that maybe there is a secular left emerging. Back in the days of the Obama administration, there were secular leaders that met, not with the president himself, but with members of the Obama administration. Yeah, they did it once. And actually, that has happened again with the Biden administration once. There is a caucus in Congress called the Free Thought Caucus. They don't want to call themselves the atheists or even the secularists. Those are still kind of loaded terms. So they're the Free Thought Caucus. They have 17 members. But they used to have four. So there's growth. Three state Democratic parties have a secular caucus at the state level. Of course, that means 47 do not, 48 if you count the District of Columbia, 49 if you count Puerto Rico. And it's also true that the Democratic National Committee passed a pro-secular resolution. Do you remember that? Do you remember it was on the front page of all the papers? No, you don't, because it was passed in 2019 and off year and made almost no ripple whatsoever in the news. So is there really a secular left? Maybe, but it's pretty much in its infancy. But you know, there's a reason why, at least yet, we've not seen the rise of this secular left movement. And it's because secularists don't have the same sort of identity that evangelicals do. Evangelicals being the heart and soul of the religious right. This just shows you data from a little measure of what we call an identity index from a big national survey. And here are people we call the secularists. We have a whole way to measure them. And you can see they're not terribly strong in their sense of identity as a secularist. In fact, we also compare them to card-carrying secularists. These are people who are members of the American Humanist Association. They pay money to a group so they can carry a card in their wallet to say that they are a dyed-in-the-wool humanist, which means the same thing as secularist. And even they don't have the same strength of identity as evangelicals. They're close, but they're really, really tiny compared to evangelicals, of course, who are an enormous group. And why don't they have such a strong sense of identity? Well, for one thing, they can't decide who they are. Also, they don't all gather together. They don't have the equivalent of a religious framework. Right? Think about religious people, how that sense of identity is reinforced. They meet typically weekly, in some traditions more than weekly, and they sing songs. And they have rites and rituals, and they go to summer camps. And they have television programs. And they have all of this subculture that reinforces their identity. And secularists have very little of that. And I could show you all sorts of evidence that secularists have limited what is sometimes called social capital. But don't take my word for it. I want you to hear from Steve Martin. That's Steve Martin, the actor, comedian, banjo player. Did you know he's a Grammy Award-winning banjo player? I think this song that you're about to hear basically sums up what I could show you in about 50 graphs. Instead, let's just listen to the song. Hallie Rose.
This is the entire atheist hymnal right here. A little tune called Atheists Don't Have No Songs. Christians have their hymns and pages.
Hymns and pages.
Hama and Aguilas for the Jews.
For the Jews.
Baptists have the Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages.
Atheists just sing the blues.
Romantics play
Clair de Lune. Born again, sing he is risen. But no one ever wrote a tune for godless existentialism. For atheists,
there's no good news.
They'll never sing a song of faith
in their songs.
They have a rule. The he is always lowercase. The he is always lowercase.
Some folks sing
a bacchantata. Lutherans get Christmas trees. Atheist songs add up to nada. But they do have Sundays free.
And of course, it's that final line that they have Sundays free. That's the main point here. You don't have the same sort of, here's a social scientific term, civic infrastructure within the secularist community that you find within the religious community. That's just a fancy way of saying they don't get together in the same way that religious folks do. Now, there's usually somebody when I give this talk in the audience who says, but what about? And they'll name a secular group that meets in a church-like way. The Sunday Assembly is one example. Such groups exist, but they're tiny, and many of you don't even know what I'm talking about. And compare that to the number of people who attend Mass, or a Protestant church, or a synagogue, or a mosque. They pale in comparison. So, what am I telling you? Remember the story about the cross-like properties on the podium? I've established that I'm really good at walking the line here. So on the one hand, there's all sorts of evidence that we should see the emergence of a secular left. Irreligion, secularism is growing. This is a politically engaged group. They're growing because of their negative reaction to a political movement. It sort of seems like, yeah, they should be primed for mobilization. On the other hand, this is a very difficult group to mobilize. Because where do you go to find them? If you want to mobilize the church people, you know where to go. You go to church. Where do you find the secular people? There are a lot of Starbucks to go to on a Sunday morning. There are a lot of them. It's hard to find them all. So here's my prediction. If some politician out there figures out how to mobilize this group and craft a common identity, then we will see a secular left. And if that seems like sort of a weaselly, waffly answer, I will remind you that if I were giving this talk in 1978 and talking about that new group of social conservatives led by this guy named Jerry Falwell, I would have said something similar. I would have said, hey, whether or not this is really going to be a thing depends on whether politicians can mobilize that group and whether they can construct a common identity for them. Because way back in the day, that group we now routinely call the evangelicals, they didn't call themselves that. They called themselves lots of different things. Even today, actually, you don't find necessary consistency. But there's more of an identity than you have among the secularists. And once you have an identity, then you have a group you can speak to, and you have a group you can speak to, you have a group you can mobilize. I'm willing to predict that there will be some politician out there who doesn't, but we haven't had one yet. Barack Obama came close, and he was sort of moving in that direction, but I don't think there's anybody currently in the Democratic ranks who's doing that, although some might figure out how. So let's sum this up. To bring you back to the beginning, why are Americans disaffiliating from religion? Well, I've hopefully made my case that it is because of this religious backlash. But does this mean that we should expect to see the emergence of a secular left? Not now, but maybe in the future. So 20 years from now, if we're talking about a secular left in the way we talk about the religious right, I want you all to remember this talk and say, oh yeah, I heard that guy from Notre Dame who accurately predicted this all. If this all fizzles out, just forget everything I told you. But have me back in about 10 or 20 years and we can talk about what's happened since. You've been a great audience. Thank you very much.
He has now agreed to take some questions, so we're going to have a quick Q&A.
Now, I want you all to know I'm quaking in my boots because I know this is a fellow member of the political science tribe.
So my question for you is, in terms of your first takeaway, is the takeaway, why are white Americans disaffiliating from religion?
Question.
And so I wonder if you could speak a little bit about the role of race in the experiments that you did.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So you are right that the trends that I have illustrated here are primarily, not entirely, but primarily among white Americans. They are not among African Americans. The African American experience with religion and politics is very different. And what seems to be happening is that when an African American hears a white religious guy talk about politics, they just say, that's just not my team. It doesn't really register with them. It's a different story, though, for Latinos, where there is a little more evidence of this. So you actually are seeing a growing trend of secularism within the Latino population. Doesn't quite match what you find among Anglo-Americans, but it's pretty close. How much of that is driven as by a negative reaction to the religious right? That's an open question. These experiments are, I will tell you, hard enough to run with the general population. To try to limit them to a subset like Latinos or African-Americans is tough. As a fellow social scientist, I hope you can appreciate that. But a very good question, because you're right. These trends are, again, primarily among whites, but not exclusively.
How about non-Christian religions?
That is, do people disaffiliate from non-Christian religions?
Yeah.
That's a good question. It kind of depends on who you count as Christian. which might seem like I'm waffling again, but that's a serious response. Because there is evidence that this is happening among Mormons. So if you count Mormons as Christians, yes. Is it happening among Jews or Muslims or Hindus or Buddhists? No. So the disaffiliation that we see is largely among Protestants, Catholics, and then sort of Protestant Catholic adjacent religious traditions.
Kind of, they're not my team.
Yeah, that's right. That's not to say that there aren't dynamics in those traditions that might also be driving secularization. That's a big concern among the American Jewish community, for example, but not as a reaction to the religious right. Should we go here? I'm supposed to be calling on people. Go ahead.
So as I understand it, in Europe as well, there's a large trend of growing irreligiosity. Do you account for that kind of for the same reasons as is happening in America, or is it a completely separate phenomenon? And also, is that phenomenon that's happening in Europe happening
in the US? I'm so glad I have my baseball bat, because this is exactly the pitch that I want. You're going to think I planted this. I did not. We have not communicated. I'm like a magician, right? We have never seen each other before. It's a good question. It is true, yes. Secularization in Europe is a thing. It is not driven by the same forces as in the United States. What you see in Europe, and that's mostly, it's Western Europe plus Britain. You can decide for yourself whether Britain is part of Europe. They can't seem to decide either. But if you group Britain with the rest of Western Europe, what you have seen is a slow and steady emergence of secularization that is largely a generational story. Generational stories happen slowly, because what a generational story means is that old people are religious, they die, and then the young people who replace them are not as religious. And then that cycle happens again and again. That's been the story in Europe. That is not what's happening in the United States, because as you saw, there is a sharp inflection point. A generational story cannot explain that sharp movement, and that's not what you see in Europe. Make sense? Over here. Ooh, we have a I like this, coordinated. It's very good.
Hi, and thank you for speaking with us. I did have a question. And you sort of touched on it a little bit, but I noticed in some of the articles you used in your experiment that it used like terms like pastor, and I think I saw one of the churches was called like Christian Fellowship Church. Yep. I'd wondered if you like saw any trends across denominations, like maybe Catholic people didn't identify with terms like that, so they weren't affected. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, that's a very good question. We debated this again. I showed you these three experiments and made it sound like, yeah, we just run these things. These are actually fairly expensive to run, so I got three. Actually, I have four. We did it again, replicated it. So we had to make some choices, and we decided that what we wanted to do, at least in this first go-around, was most closely replicate what you would find in the real world. And what you most often find in the real world are candidates who use religion speaking in very Protestant terms, even if, and here's the kicker, even if they are actually Catholic. And often, whether or not they're Protestant or Catholic is kind of murky. Marco Rubio is a good example of that. Rubio actually manages to he's like the Trinity. He simultaneously is Mormon, Catholic, and Protestant at the same time. And I don't, which I know, I shouldn't have said that, and I don't, my point is, strike that from the record. I'm not trying to make fun of Marco Rubio, or the Trinity for that matter. He describes this in his autobiography, I'm not making this up. He was baptized in the Mormon church when he was 10 or 11. His family were active in that church for a short time, and then he's actually Catholic by birth, but he often attends a Protestant church. That is very, very common. Mike Pence has a similar story. John McCain actually had a similar story. He's an Episcopalian, but when he was back in Arizona, he attended an evangelical megachurch. So in our experiments, we are using, I'll admit, very Protestant-centric language, because that's what you find. Now, I have actually long been intrigued. Well, what would happen, actually, if it wasn't so Protestant-y? However, what we do know is Catholics do seem to react in the same way. That is, unlike the Jews who don't think, or the black Protestants who don't think of this as their team, the Catholics do. Again, mind-blowing. These are two groups who for a long time didn't get along. John F. Kennedy would be saying, what? I went through all of that because of my Catholicism, and now the Catholics and Protestants are best friends? Good question. Thank you. Are we done? Oh, folks. Oh, we've got one more. There's always that kid.
Yeah, I hate to be that kid who goes again. But I did have a question. You talked a little bit at the end about Jerry Falwell and those trends around sort of when the emergence began. And at the beginning, you were talking about the time period and how your model fits the time period best. It sort of looked like it was a late 80s trend. I guess what I'm asking is, how would you explain the, you know, Reagan Revolution mm-hmm. organization in the early 80s as not showing up in that trend?
Well, what you saw in the Reagan years was the beginning of the religious right, okay? But you still didn't have the close association, at least regular voters were not making that association in their heads between religion and the Republican Party. That doesn't come until the late 1980s, and one of the reasons for that is at the time, like throughout the Reagan years of the 80s, okay, white evangelicals were still predominantly Democrats, not Republicans. They were beginning to shift, but you don't really see that shift until the late 80s, early 90s. Okay? And the reason why we think the late 80s, early 90s are so critical is that's when Pat Robertson runs as a Republican presidential candidate. He was actually a pastor and was well known because of his television program. In 1992, you have Pat Buchanan running for the Republican nomination. Doesn't win, obviously, but gives this very fiery speech at the Republican convention in which he declares a culture war, which at the time was considered to be controversial, and today would be like, eh. So that's what's happening at that time, because it takes a while for voters to sort of realize that these coalitions are shifting. And so we think it's at that time that they begin to see it, and then it gets reinforced again and again and again. All right. Now I think we're really done. Thank you very much. Oh, no, there's one more. Okay, this will really be the last one.
I don't want to be burdened, so I apologize.
No. Well, I stay all night. I got nothing else to do. But
So you talked about former President Trump's transactional approach mm-hmm. To his relationship with Christians. You know, there's the famous photo of him holding the gay pride flag, and more recently he's talked about how in future campaigns Republicans need to drop their abortion rhetoric. So is there any sort of indication that Trump's more transactional, perhaps more secularized approach is pushing the Republican Party in a more secularized direction?
No. and the reason for that is, there's this great conundrum that many people have wrestled with. Like, how is it that Trump could have such support among evangelicals? And part of it is because he speaks to a sense of cultural embattlement that many evangelicals, and not just evangelicals, I should say, actually, a lot of church-going Catholics often fit into that category, and other groups as well. And so, by appealing to their sense of cultural embattlement, even if he makes comments about gay rights, he's actually always been somewhat, in his rhetoric, supportive of gay rights. His administration wasn't, but he personally, as a candidate, actually never really said anything much about LGBTQ stuff. That just wasn't really his thing. And he clearly wasn't really comfortable on the issue of abortion. But he treated those issues, again, in a very transactional way. He promised to put Supreme Court justices on the court to overturn Roe, and voila, he did. And it happened, right? I think that that base of the Republican Party, at least in its current form, is so rock solid that it would take, not even Donald Trump could move the party away from those positions in the short to medium term. That doesn't mean in the long term that's necessarily what's going to happen, but that's where we're at now. And that's why you're gonna see this titanic battle in the Republican primaries between Trump and DeSantis and maybe others who get in the race as well. And the battle will largely be over who can win the evangelical vote, which of course Trump has already demonstrated he can do or has done in the past. We'll see if he succeeds. But that's apparently we're gonna do one more, but this really will be the last one.
Just a quick question, actually. You see any parallels, there's a lot of talk about the divide economically, socially between college graduates versus non-college graduates when it comes to politics. Does that apply, for example, are the secularists more educated than the, I don't know if that's a kind of general
question. No, that's a good question. There's a long answer and a short answer. I'll give you the short one. But if you want to talk about the long one afterwards, I can. Short answer is secular population is complicated. I've grouped them all together. That's not really accurate. Think of them as being in two camps. There are those who define their secularism by what they are not. Okay, they're not religious. Those people, not terribly college educated. If you've ever read Hillbilly Elegy, the people that J.D. Vance, his kin that he describes in that book, they would be the non-religious. They define themselves by what they are not. They're not part of organized religion and not college educated. The secularists, those people who have an actively secular worldview, that is, they know what they are. They don't define themselves by what they're not. They define themselves by what they are. They are a humanist. They are a secularist. They are a free thinker. They use lots of different terms. Those people are highly educated. And that's one reason why they're very politically engaged. So there's kind of a divide even within that population. Now we're really done. although I'm happy to stick around and answer other questions, but I'm conscious of people's time.
Thank you to everyone who engaged in our Q&A, and thank you so much, Dr. Campbell, for this insightful discussion about how there is the rise of irreligion, but how this can be connected to the fusion with religion and politics. And we wanted to offer you this gift from the McConnell Center.
Thank you.
A token of our appreciation.
Can I open it?
Yeah, sure.
Let's see what it is. Is it bourbon? Oh, look at that. It's a book. Thank you very much.
And thanks to all those who are watching on YouTube or for listening to this as a podcast. I hope you all join us again on February 8th for our host, Dr. Kevin Cosby, as he talks about the power of empathy. You can join us live here in the Chow Auditorium or online on YouTube. TPS scholars can meet upstairs. Everyone else, thank you for coming and get out of here safely.
Thank you for your help.